On For Now, through good times and bad, through the highs and the lows, Dave and Steve are best friends.
Going for real? Is this for real now? They just start. You see, they don't tell you. They warn you.
Actually, mate. Well,
I. sorry, I went a bit high pitched there. How did we meet? How did we meet, or how did I first know of him? When did I first see him?
That's wonderful. That's so wonderful.
Ultimately met in an audition situation when David came and auditioned for the first time
in my life.
And was
I've never auditioned. Thank you. Close up. Thank you. I've never auditioned for a play in my life ever. I've always been asked to do things, and this one says, "Would you mind auditioning?" I thought, cheeky mare. She knows what I can do. But anyway, I.
But you did it.
I did audition, and I was terribly, terribly nervous because I'd never done an audition. I was so scared, and I desperately wanted this part. It was so good. It was this woman, demon, monster from hell. I was so nervous about getting this part, but I did get the part, and I did it, didn't I?
Yes.
Fab. We had a ball.
Fantastic.
It was really, really good.
So that was our first experience of each other.
Oh, God, they're nice. Fantastic. Oh, they're
yeah. I think that's the one right up in front.
That's brown.
No, not brown.
Not brown.
No, I lit up the black one. Think of that, two of them at the front like that, rather than going like... That.
What else do they have?
What about those women? They're a bit whorehousey, aren't they, as you say? Yeah, I quite like those, but I think they're going to get lost on stage. I've got a pelvic, I'd be far more funny than that.
What is your act, actually?
We're called the Eager Divas. There's three of us.
You're a beaver missing,
aren't
you?
I'm a beaver?
I've had a beaver missing for 35 years.
Oh, I'm joining the club.
How are you feeling? I'll get
that
for you, just a second.
I need £3, sorry.
As soon as 96 arrived, which was, you know, something of an apocalyptic year for both of us, and my mom died very, very suddenly in January, shortly followed by David's partner.
Dying.
In February. When did Dave die?
Dave died the 12th of February 1996. And your mum died
on the 11th of January. So
a month,
give or take. And that was I mean, what a way to bond. But that was a very, very bonding.
I think that's what did it, don't you?
Experience for both of us. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't that. You know, I was going through something similar. You know, I was not the kind of person that would come out with a handful of cliches at the drop of a hat. You know, it was actually easier for me to say, you know, David, you have got to move on. You've got to take a step, even if it's only a small step.
Mm.
You know, this is going to kill you.
It wasn't that I didn't want to. So I didn't know how to, and I wanted answers. I wanted to know where Dave was. I wanted to know, was I going to feel any better than this? It was like an illness. I didn't want to live. I didn't want to carry on.
I kind of like was very proactive in sorting out my mother's estate. So, and that went on for about 7 months. You know, it was a long period of time. And all that time, I was just flying on adrenaline. You know, and when I'm in those situations, when I'm challenged, you know, and the more challenged I get, and the more confronted I feel, the more I actually will rise to that.
I went the other way. I went to the depths of despair. I didn't want to live anymore. You know, I'd had it. That was it. Dave was dead. I was dead. When he died, I died. And because we were like one person. You know, we were together for 19 years. I was 17 years old when I met David. he died when he was 36, and we were together that whole time. Yeah, I just went really, really down, and I think Steve just kind of pulled me up a bit. I think we come to a level where Steve was kind of here and I was there, and we both went like that.
I crashed horribly, and I think I probably experienced some of the dullness, you know, when everything just seems dull and just monotone, and nothing has any colour to it, nothing has any brightness to it, nothing has anything, there's no light to anything.
Steve was going through a real kind of, as you say, like a dark grey period in his life, where mine was becoming a slightly more colourful. I was doing things I wanted to do. I was working again in the theatre, which was where, you know, I had no idea I was going to do again. I was doing panto and plays and that, and Steve was getting low. And I think that might have been a time when we decided to do the act. Was it around then?
I'm just trying to think when we first... When did we first talk
about
it?
I just suggested that we would do an
act. Because you'd suggested, David had suggested doing the act, and I'd
always said, no, not doing drag.
What do you mean, not doing drag? I don't know. I'll be live. No, it was never that. Going to a cemetery to do a photo shoot with David in vampire attire. And
tasteful.
And I said in the car, I'll do the act with you. If this other friend of ours, Edward, agreed to do it as well, I said, I'll do it.
Doing the act has been very stimulating for me as well, because I don't feel it's a drag act.
5 weeks from now, we're going to have a show.
This is the Valley Combination. Girls, second group follow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
We do wear dresses. We do wear dresses.
So if that's
a... But it's not a typical drag act. We don't stand there and say, hello, darling, how are you? Funny place to keep an air jog and all that kind of rubbish.
No, you do that in your other act.
That means that... Oh. I'm now in a relationship. I've been with someone for a year, and I didn't think that I would ever be able to fall in love again. I didn't think the time would ever come when I would actually say to someone else, I love you. And it's such a nice feeling to know that there's someone very, very special in my life I really care a lot about.
Too old for this, Lark. We're not having any children.
Karamula, tick, tick, naka, naka, tara, poo, poo.
Sir, and you might do even better to remember that slightly more obscure saying, ding-a-lingy, wicky, yip, yip, shaky bum bum. So I can have a dinner party, maybe you can meet the man of your dreams or you're not looking.
Mm.
Yeah, right.
I don't want a man of my dreams.
I don't.
Well, if somebody came along, I mean, the way I talk about, you know, partners sounds as if I'm allergic to them, and that's not the case. Mm. If somebody came along, then, you know, the portal of possibility is always open.
I think you're right not to go looking for it.
The thing is, if I felt that there was something missing out of my life, then I'd probably be out there in the marketplace, you know, looking to see what was on offer. But I don't feel anything is particularly missing.
Like some of the gay couples I know who have been together, say, for more than, say, 3 years or something, the rest of their friends put this immense pressure on them to stay together because they have to prove it's a gay relationship that works.
I know. I'm perfectly happy, you know, the way I am. Mm. Perfectly happy.
Well, there you are. Good for you.
So?
I'm jealous.
Don't be, darling, I'm here.
I know.
I'm here, darling. Aww. Darling.
Oh, get off.
We're just moving in together now. Is that a bit good, isn't it? Be the happy housewife, huh?
Leave David at home to do the housework.
And you got to work. You're going to keep me in the lifestyle I'm accustomed to.
I don't know about that. You can do work in the evening.
Oh, thanks.
I'll just go to bed.
I was very pleased and I was very relieved because it was what you wanted more than anything else. You know, a lot of people need a relationship to define part of them. And that was very important for David. So I was really, really pleased.
Oh, blimey.
My heart stops in my mouth when he goes up this thing.
I feel, I don't know, complete again, if that's the way to put it. And I'm just one of those people that needs to be in a relationship.
Oh, my nerves are in shreds now. How was it going?
But the right relationship, not just any relationship for the sake of filling a void, but because I'm happy and content and relaxed and in love and think the world of that person. That is what Simon does for me, and it's fantastic. I feel complete again. I feel like a full, a whole person. Where before, like Stephen said, I thought I'd had a limb removed, and now I feel really good about myself.
This wig feels like stuffing out your sofa.
It's an old wig, I've had it since I was 22. Like,
that's much better, yeah. That's the right size.
It's got a sort of Eastern Promise look to it, hasn't it?
I don't know what the promise is, but I know what you mean.
Bear.
Bear. Oh, that looks better. That looks better.
It needs to be
bent
by home, isn't it? So I'm gonna score it again.
Tootsie.
That's right. Yeah, that you should have gone for that great big long one. Oh. Like that,
they weren't red. They are the right width. It's just the length is a bit too long, but that looks right.
He supports me, but you can't... No, he doesn't, actually. Not physically making costumes and stuff like that, but he has been responsible for our new publicity photographs, which are fabulous. Yeah, so that'd be okay. I mean, we'll try and contribute as much as we can, but, I mean, can I help it if I'm the one with all the talent, darling?
No.
I think theirs better. Yeah. Don't you?
That looks nice too, but I liked it at the angle. I like the...
Well, it's the Pete Edwards on there. He could tell me what he thought.
I'm sure he'd like it the way I liked it.
Do you think so?
I'm sure he would.
I think... I don't like it. I look like horns. It's like I've got horns on one's drop.
Well, then you've obviously made your mind up, so why are you asking me? We fell out. We fell out because... both our lives at one point last year went off in very different directions, and we were both under enormous pressure. And those little things that build up when anybody works together, and this is a pretty weird way to work together, you know, going off 3 or 4 nights a week, midnight, performing at midnight. So you set off to work. So you're on your way to work at 9 at night, you know, with your suitcases and your bags of wigs.
There was the two of us directing it, choreographing it, when it should have just been one of us. And it had always been my act, it had always been my idea. And the show that we were doing was all my ideas, and it was going really, really well. But then Stephen said, and Edward said, that, you know, if we're going to be in this trio, we would like some kind of input, which is fair enough. And I thought, OK, they're both artistic people. I'll give them some input. They can have as much input as they like. But I didn't like it. I didn't want anyone stepping on my toes.
It just didn't work.
It didn't work.
It was a formula which didn't work.
You coming to me? Oh, right. One shot the woman.
Wonderful.
Oh, I touched your tongue!
Oh, I'm fine. You'll be the first. Or the last.
We said a lot of cruel things to each other, and it really, really hurt. Of course it hurt. You know, I'm human, and especially from someone that's a friend. And so I decided that it was best that we didn't come into contact with each other anymore.
I didn't hold on, you know, to any of the to any of the crap that we were dishing out to one another at that time. And I knew that within the space of 3 or 4 weeks, that if I saw David, regardless of where it was, if I bumped into him, I'd be happy to see him, and I'd say, let's have a coffee.
Stephen rung and was like, hello, how are you? I thought, my God,
what's the same thing?
How are you? Well, sort of in between that, you know, sort of masculinely girlish.
That'll do, that's acceptable. And,
masculinely, anyway.
It's a new word, it's a word now.
And then we just met up at Victoria, didn't we?
And it was like
coffee, and it was like nothing had happened.
Like nothing had happened.
It was just bizarre.
It was the best thing we could have done.
Yeah.
Was to get back together again. And it works perfectly.
And now it's better than before.
And it's like much better than before. There's no hidden agendas.
And I'm in charge. And I'm Mr. Demir.
You got 18.
Are they big 8?
Everyone fits, I think, basically, isn't it?
Yeah.
Can we just try?
Like high heel.
That's nicer if you've got that and that fits. Can we try one of those?
Do they do any sort of women-sized shoes that's big? Or they're all eight? Because eight's quite big anyway, isn't it?
The largest is an eight.
Right, OK.
Oh, yes.
Right. Fingers crossed. They're nice too, aren't they?
If they don't fit, you're not marrying the prince.
Ooh, oh, misses. Come on. Mind you, the strap, look.
From the daintier foot, thanks. It's a miracle.
Not on yet, love.
You've got a size 8.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Remember, they stretch as well in
I know,
time.
But we'll just have to get him some. And then, if they don't fit him, he'll have to come back tomorrow and change them.
Yeah, is that all right to do that? We've got the cute receipt, the three of us.
Those are fantastic.
These are great. Perfect. Oh, I don't believe it. That's a first.
We didn't expect this.
I bet they didn't either.
OK, if you could just pop my trainers in a bag and I'll leave in these.
Great. So, should I take them?
Oh, I don't... Oh,
I'm
gonna have to think about it.
No, I'm driving mad sometimes talking about frocks and fabric and wigs and that. And Dave, that was something Dave never liked. He used to say, look, shut up, I'm not interested in drag, you know. But Simon will sit and listen and he'll make suggestions and he'll find me money-saving devices and things like that, which is so sweet, really, because not many people put up with that. When you meet other people, when you meet possible relationships and you tell them that you do drag, they really frown on it, they really turn away from it, and they're not interested in it at all. And Simon, one of the first things I said to him was, look, before you go any further, you better know that I do a drag act. And you were fine about it, weren't you? Most people freak. It's a bit of a... Oh, my furniture. Don't want to go straight through. Comfy.
Yeah.
Right, now tell me about that geezer you met.
Why?
He's met someone.
I've met someone who's coming tomorrow night and who doesn't know that I'm going to be a beautiful lady.
Mm. God, you've only got till tomorrow night to get made up, love. You better start now.
He knows. He knows I'm on stage.
Look at
this. He knows that I'm on stage, and he know doesn't know what I'm doing.
He thinks he's a soldier in Miss Saigon,
and so he's going to find out
that he's not a soldier in Miss Saigon. He's actually Miss Saigon. So what are you going to say to him then?
I'm not going to say anything to him.
Why not?
I will. I'm just.
I'll tell him. I'll say, you know she's a tranny, don't you?
Well, I think he'll actually see my true, see me in a very different light.
That'd be the last
as soon as I step on the stage.
I think that's the trouble with drag is that, as far as other gay men go, you do instantly become you're a minority group within a minority group if you're a drag artist. I don't know why that is. A lot of gay people don't like to think that we exist, that we're just like a fallacy. And a lot of gay people don't like to think that they're sort of limp-wristed Nelly handbag-swinging queens around, but there are. And there always will be, whether they like it or not. So it's a bit awkward being... Excuse me. Pardon, how rude. Your hair's come out there, Edward.
It's nothing like true colours, isn't it?
True colours.
He's coming at 11. No, he knows we're on at 11. I'm very confused. He knows we're on at 11. And that's just how we've left it. He said, I'm sure I'll be there, which was a bit different to, no, I will be there. So obviously I think there's a little bit of fear setting in. Your intrepidation, but that's all right. I'm not even thinking about him. Do you think he'll come?
She lives in a sad, twisted world.
That's fine. It's my twisted world, and I'm happy with it. Get your own.
Got one, then. Got two.
I've shorn my manly chest just for tonight.
Oh, and it's down, I like that.
Thank you. Good evening, gentlemen, ladies. Please join me in welcome to the stage three shy, retiring, but very talented young ladies. They go under the names of Rita Haystack, Priceless McCaw, and Bella DeBall. Gentlemen, ladies, please give it up for Eager Divas!
On the steps down here, and he could have gone to the loo, he could have gone to the bar, he could have gone home, which I think is the possible option. But he had his hand over his mouth,
here he is.
Which is, you know, people do it when they're embarrassed or they don't know how to react. So, you know, what can I say? How could you resist this?
What can I say? She said everything.
I would have thought I would have gone up a notch on the irresistible scale, but obviously not. I've been manless for too long to care, you know. And it's a conversation that we've had on many occasions.
Manless?
Yes.
You've not been manless.
Manless wanted.
You may have been without male, you know, without a husband.
I mean on the relationship front, you know.
When it comes to anything else, she's had more than any of us put together, love.
I've got a big cake in the cupboard, so I'm perfectly happy. And some turkey bagels and gherkins. There's more than one way to get meat in your mouth. God. That's what my great-great-grandmother used to say way, way, way back in the war when the old king was on the throne. Shall I get out of this now?
That's when our grandmother could get a word in.
If I shut up, you say, why are you quiet? Can't
breathe. Oh, yes, old Charles, and you are very lucky to be as calm and happy as you are. For you have no idea how very lucky you have to be when you become a star. If you believe it's just a life of glamour, of jewels and furs and parties all night long, of critics' praise and fans and all in glamour, believe me, cher Hortense, you will be wrong.
And Best Friends concludes next Wednesday at the same time. And if you face problems like Steve and Dave, there's a Channel 4 information line with sources of help and support. The number to call is 08456 1020.